Mostly clear tonight, overnight lows upper 30s to mid 40s. This is NHPR.
This is The Exchange. I'm Laura Kanoy. It's our Race for the First series. Each Monday, we talk with one of the many candidates running for New Hampshire's first congressional district. And let's hear from you, especially if you live in the first district. Our email is exchange@nhpr.org, or use Facebook or Twitter at NHPR Exchange. The phone number is 1-800-892-6477. And you can also watch our interview on Facebook Live. Our candidate today is Democrat Maura Sullivan. She's a Marine who served in Iraq, a former Obama administration official working at both the Department of Veterans Affairs and also at the Pentagon. And Maura Sullivan, it's really nice to meet you. Thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me, Laura. It's great to be here this morning and a gorgeous day. Really appreciate you having me on.
Well, we're on the sixth floor here in the building. So give us that 30-second elevator speech from floor one to floor six, Maura, on why first district voters should choose you.
What really, Laura, stems from, you know, my commitment to service. I come from a family committed to service. And then I've been serving our country for most of my adult life. I served for a little more than 5 years in the Marines. I fought in the Iraq War and trained in Japan and trained in Korea, and then was proud to serve for a little more than 6 years in the Obama administration, where I was appointed by President Obama to serve on the leadership team of the Department of Veterans Affairs and served at the Pentagon.
I want to ask you about your time at Veterans Affairs. You've said in a lot of your campaign materials, Maura Sullivan, that you came to the department during the crisis of 2014. Just remind us, what was that crisis?
It was, about 4 years ago, actually last month, Laura, when 40 veterans died in Phoenix, and it was believed to be due to long wait times.
Wow, was that long a time ago?
Yeah, 4 years, 4 years ago now. And I went down to Washington shortly thereafter to be a part of the new leadership team that was coming into the department that ultimately helped to implement the Veterans Choice Act, which got veterans access to care in the community, and got veterans who were on wait lists quicker access to care.
So Veterans Choice was kind of the alternative to this supposedly slow bureaucratic plodding VA system.
Well, I would call it an addition.
An addition.
And the reason for that, why that's so critical, I think, Laura, is, you know, if you are a veteran in North Conway who has to, Vietnam veteran who has to get care, you know, three times a week, you know, physical therapy or mental health care for post-traumatic stress from Vietnam, you know, we as a country need to make sure that that veteran can access care, where he or she is.
Right down the street.
Right down the street.
Instead of driving all the way to Manchester.
It's just not sustainable, particularly, as I said, for things like physical therapy and mental health care. And so that's why, you know, we need to strengthen our VA. We need to strengthen our VA medical centers, but we also need to strengthen the ability for veterans to have access to care right there in their communities.
So I remember when this happened in Phoenix, and there was all sorts of conversation around the country and here in New Hampshire. Then this choice program, as you said, came into play. Then there were criticisms about that. The Government Accountability Office found that choice participants maybe waited up to 70 days to receive care because of bureaucratic requirements and deadlines. So there was a lot of controversy about that as well. I just wonder what went wrong. This was supposed to reduce wait times. Mm-hmm. And in some instances, it was incredibly frustrating.
Well, look, it was, it was not perfect legislation. Few legislation is. But it was an attempt and a step, I think, in the right direction to try to get veterans off of wait lists and also veterans who lived, more than 30 miles from a VA medical center, you know, access to care right there in the community. The recent efforts that we've seen on the VA Mission Act continue to make sure that veterans who were receiving care due to choice funding have the ability to continue to get care. You know, look, some people argue that, you know, we need to strengthen our VA medical centers. Others argue that we need to strengthen care in the community. I'll tell you, we need both. We need both. Now, some people will say that that's expensive. My response to them is, so is war. And if the United States of America's Department of Defense can spend, you know, $700 billion a year on defense spending, we can do, and we need to do, a better job as a country in caring for the really 1% of men and women around this country who raise their right hand and serve to support and defend the Constitution of the United States. You know, that's what I'd be focused on is as a member of Congress from this district.
Doing both. strengthening the VA system and continuing this expansion of access to private sector care in the community.
Absolutely, because it's what our veterans need, and particularly, Laura, in the more rural areas of our state.
When you were at the VA, Ms. Sullivan, did you foresee these problems that did come out with this Choice Act? I mean, this was huge, huge headlines about veterans waiting a long time, being on hold, and all sorts of terrible stories. Did you foresee that it would roll out this bumpily?
Yeah, we were focused on trying to get veterans access to care and getting veterans off of wait lists and again, particularly focused on people who lived in more rural areas that lived too far from a VA medical center. But look, there's a lot that we need to do to strengthen the Manchester VA. And I'll tell you, when I served at the VA working for President Obama, I was appointed by him again in 2014. I traveled as part of my job as an assistant secretary there to VA hospitals all around our country. You want the best palliative care at the VA, it's in Martinsburg, West Virginia. The best mental health centers at Heinz VA Medical Center. The best artificial limb centers in Lower Manhattan. The best polytrauma center is in Palo Alto, California. The best women's clinic is in Washington, D.C. I've seen all of them. I know what excellent looks like. And I know how to raise my hand on behalf of the veterans of our state and demand that same excellence in care at our Manchester VA. Because our veterans deserve that here. And if veterans in Palo Alto and in West Virginia get that care, then Granite State veterans are going to as well.
You know, we spoke to another veteran who's running in this race, Terrence O'Rourke, who served in Iraq as you did. He said, in terms of foreign policy, he just thinks the U.S. should get out of the Middle East. Just get out. Mm-hmm. I wonder what you think about that.
Well, I think, to be clear, the way that this president has engaged on matters of national security has put our country at risk. His erratic communication style, particularly over social media, is just, not how to conduct matters of national security and diplomacy. When you see, conversations with unstable actors, like we saw with the leader of North Korea, over social media, that's really, really concerning.
Although they're sitting down almost as we speak, right? And a lot of people are saying, hey, that's a pretty big coup for this president to have a face-to-face with North Korea, a North Korea that seems maybe possibly willing to give up its nuclear weapons. So is that a diplomatic success for the president?
Well, Laura, I spent a lot of time, I trained in Korea when I was stationed in Japan in the Marines, and then was really proud when I served in the Obama administration to travel to our UN cemetery in Korea to honor the more than 33,000 Americans that gave their lives in the Korean conflict. It is certainly encouraging to see discussions with North Korea, but I think we just need to, be very realistic about what this is, which is just discussions. And the real success is going to be in the follow-through and in the details. And the United States is going to have to unilaterally and potentially multilaterally verify, what Kim Jong-un is saying. And again, I think it's just important to just, kind of focus on what this is, which is just discussions. But the real success, if there is any, is going to be in the follow-through.
I want to remind our listeners that they can join us. The number is 1-800-892-6477. It's our Race for the First series, where each Monday here in the Exchange, we meet one of the many candidates for New Hampshire's first congressional district. This week, it's Democrat Maura Sullivan. Next week, we talk with Republican Andy Sanborn. You can join us. Send us an email, exchange@nhpr.org. And here's one that just came in from Garrett, who says, could you please ask Ms. Sullivan to assess Carol Shea Porter's performance in office and explain how she would be different? Good question, Garrett. Thank you very much.
Well, Garrett, thanks for listening in and being a part of this today. I think Congresswoman Shea Porter has done a terrific job advocating for our shipyard and advocating for Pease as a member of the House Armed Services Committee. And I would look to continue and follow in her footsteps. I would be proud to follow in her footsteps as a member of that committee. She recently secured more than $150 million to update one of our dry docks at the shipyard. And she's done very good work advocating for holding the Pentagon accountable about the contaminants that they have in their firefighting chemicals. And that affects us right here at Pease. So she's done a terrific job doing that. I'd make the case on my first day in office to follow in her footsteps and serve on that committee. And I'll tell you, one of the first things I'd be focused on is our military families. You know, there is a wait list right now, Garrett, at the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard for our child care centers. I spoke to a gentleman at the shipyard, and he was telling me about a woman on his team who, about 2.5 years ago, put her name on the wait list for child care at our shipyard.
2.5 years.
2.5 years, when she was pregnant. And her, you know, she now has a 2-year-old, and she is paying for, this is one of the employees of the shipyard, she is paying for daycare out in town because there's not enough capacity in the child care center at the shipyard. So that's one of the first questions I'd be asking as a member of the House Armed Services Committee on behalf of our community and our state. Because if the Pentagon can spend $700 billion a year, you know, we needed to do a better job of taking care of our community members and our families.
Well, thank you for the question, Garrett. And again, you can send us an email, exchange@nhpr.org. Here's another one that came in from Alex in Manchester, who says, do you support getting access for health care for all? Do you support single payer so that all can access the care they need? Thank you, Alex, for the email.
Alex, thanks. Thanks for being a part of this. I was in Manchester this weekend and enjoyed a great meeting with Democrats there. Thanks for being on today. You know, one of the biggest challenges and concerns I hear from people all around our state is about access to health care. And I hear it from seniors. I hear it from students. I hear it from young moms around my age. It's too, health care is too expensive. I hear it from small business owners. Let's be really clear. We have right now a Republican president and members of Congress that are trying to take away access to health care. I mean, just this past week, trying to take away access, you know, for people with pre-existing conditions. That is just wrong. That is absolutely wrong.
So do you support Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All type style that he advocated in the last election?
Here's what I'd be focused on. We ultimately, Laura, need to get to a place where every Granite Stater and every person in our country can access quality, affordable health care, period. And look, I've served on the leadership team of the largest integrated healthcare system in our country, the VA, and I've seen firsthand the access, you know, the challenges of access and cost to care. I know them well. There's a few first steps that I think we can do in this Congress. First, I think we need a public option. We need to make sure that everybody, has the ability to buy into Medicare, because there are places where, you know, private options aren't good.
So how would you pay for that on the taxpayer level? I mean, Medicare, most people who are on it love it, say it's great, but expanding that to the general population could be quite expensive.
Yeah, I think, look, we're going to have to make some very tough choices. But to be clear, we're not going to do them on the backs of seniors or the most disadvantaged in our society or children. There's a few, where I'd start is not giving millionaires and billionaires a tax break. But to be clear, we're not going to do it on the backs of seniors or our kids. So, and we've got to fight fiercely right now to protect health care. I think we've also got, Medicare's got to be able to negotiate for prescription prices. We could at the VA, VHA could. People get sticker shock when they go to pick up their prescriptions. And you got small business owners that can't afford to offer their employees health insurance.
So not a fan of the tax bill.
That's just not sustainable.
Because I think Republicans campaigning this fall will say, hey, America, we gave you a tax cut. Look at the Democrats. They want to get rid of your tax cut. So is that a successful strategy to say, I'm running against that tax cut that the Republicans gave you?
I mean, I think that the cuts to, billionaires did not, were not necessary. And at a critical time in our country where, we're cutting to the Department of Education's budget by, 5%, where, people can't afford to purchase health insurance, where, we've one of the only industrialized countries in the world that doesn't have a great, paid family leave policy. We don't need to be giving billionaires a tax break. So that's what I'd be focused on.
Well, so much more that we could talk about. I'm going to move on to gun safety or gun control, call it what you want. As a Marine, Maura Sullivan, you've talked a lot about your experience with guns. You said you had one strapped to your leg for protection. I've heard you say a couple times, I've fired them, I cleaned them, I stored them, I know them inside and out. And you've said also, quoting here, these weapons of war don't belong in our communities. What do you mean by that? These weapons of war don't belong in our communities. Is that a ban on certain types of weapons? Is that what you're asking for?
Yeah, I mean, Laura, First of all, I'm really proud to have earned the Moms Demand Action Gun Sense designation in our campaign. And also, I was the first candidate in this race to pledge not to take a dime from the NRA. I mean, look.
Which they probably wouldn't give you anyway, given that you've gotten the Mom Sense endorsement. But go ahead.
As you said, I have a lot of experience with weapons, as you mentioned. Part of my job in the Marines was overseeing the storage, the safe storage of weapons. And, as a Marine, you train on many weapon systems. So I have fired automatic weapons, many, many times.
Right. So what does that mean, these weapons of war don't belong in our communities? Is that a ban on certain styles of weapons?
Yeah, I think we need to, just to be clear, I'd be focused on my first day in office. I mean, we need to ban assault weapons. We need to ban high-capacity magazines. There's also some really common-sense procedures. And I got to tell you, these are pretty common sense. More than 90% of Americans think we need background checks and agree with that. We need background checks. We need to close the gun show loophole. And I'll tell you, Laura, I think the way we get this done in this next Congress, and I'm cautiously optimistic we're going to be able to, I think veterans in Congress are going to lead it. And I'm confident we can do that because we've got some real experience with these things. We've got some real experience with these things. And I'll tell you, I talk to people that I serve with in the Marines, and we don't agree on everything. But we do agree on this. I mean, some of these automatic weapons that that Marines used in Fallujah, in Ramadi, in Baghdad, in Afghanistan, we needed them there. We just don't need them here. You don't need them for hunting, for fishing, for personal protection. And again, I think veterans coming together in Congress and showing some real moral and political courage is how we are going to get this done and ultimately make sure that our kids are safe going to school.
I have to ask you one last question, and this is a question you've been asked a lot on the campaign trail. You're a relative newcomer to New Hampshire. You've addressed this in your campaign. You say, I've served in the country overseas, I've served in Washington, ready to settle down. So setting that aside, you have received, Ms. Sullivan, a lot of outside money from individuals and outside groups. How should voters view that outside money?
Sure. I'm really proud of all the support that our campaign has received. We've received grassroots contributions from all around the state. We have, $3 from students at UNH and St. A's, from moms that are worried about gun violence, from some veterans who've never even been involved in politics before, have reached out to our campaign and contributed. And I'm really proud of all that support. And I'm also really proud of the support from, people that I served with in the Marines, in Iraq and when I trained
from
in Japan
the country.
And from all around the country. And I'm also very proud of the support I've received for former colleagues of mine in the Obama administration that, think
so that's
that,
where some of that comes from. I'm so sorry to interrupt you. We are slaves to the clock. we'll wrap it up there. It was really good to have you on. Thank you.
Great to be here, Laura. Thanks so much. And thanks, everyone, for tuning in. Looking forward to seeing you out in the campaign trail.
The views expressed in this program are those of the individuals and not those of NHPR, its Board of Trustees, or its underwriters. If you missed part of today's